You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download. Well, welcome back to Exercise 6, where we're going to start to finish off our effect. Now, if you've been following me all the way, you'll notice that my node tree is slightly different than it was at the end of the previous exercise. I've just tried to simplify the connections a little bit, and I've also color-coded some of these dots so that I know where things are coming from. And we can see that the basis of the effect is here. Like I think I said before, not worry too much about dodgy roto going on over at the side here. We're going to sort that out soon. Let's think about the core of the effect, which is going to be the transition from him having a normal hand to it being completely affected by the wall. So we're simply going to add in a bit of a transition into our node tree. And we can either add this in, you know, after the hold or after the transform. I think we'll start after the transform. We'll see how it goes. Now we could manually come in here and keyframe up different mask areas, or I could sort of just cheat and have everything coming in, you know, relatively the same time. Let's do a proof of concept first, and then we'll refine this as we go. So cast your mind back a long, long time ago when we were talking about the different node categories, and I said that we had Sapphire available to us. And this is the full version of BorisFX Sapphire. So it has a few hundred different plugins to work with, including transitions. Now I should say at this moment, Sapphire only appears in the standalone version of Silhouette. If you're using the plugin version of Silhouette, you won't have Sapphire here. You'll have to do this in a different way. But under Sapphire, we have Sapphire transitions. And if I come down a little bit here, we have a whole category that's dedicated to wipes. So we have wipe blobs, wipe bubble, wipe cells, wipe checker, and so on and so forth. I'm going to start looking at wipe clouds, though. I'm just going to bring this in, and I'm just going to come into image and add in a couple of colors so we can see what this is doing. So let's take this going from, oh, that's a beautiful color, Ben. And that's an even nicer color. All right, let's just plug those in there and keyframe the wipe amount. And you can see that sort of just transitioning in with clouds. I think we do have some presets here. Let's load up the presets, see what we've got. It's always a good place to start. And Sapphire Effects have their own preset browser. The built-in Silhouette Effects have presets down in the parameters area. That could be interesting. Let's have a look at Skyfall. This just seems like a regular little one there. Steam rising. Oh, that could be good. Actually, we'll take steam rising. There we go. And I'm going to change one thing about that. And I'm going to change my angle. So you can see here down at the grad angle there. We're going to have that going that way instead. Yeah, so it's just going to come in like that. All right, that's kind of what we need. So let's come in and move our wipe clouds over. And we know how to take this away. We just waggle this. I just want to show you there's another way of doing it. Up at the top here is extract. Little button, the extract button, or E, I believe, is the keyboard shortcut for it. And we'll just bring this over into here. So now if we take a little look here, we're going to wipe this on. If I press A, we can see the alpha overlay there. Okay, so now a little word of caution, and the reason that I've left in a little bit of a gap here. When we're feeding stuff through the tree down here, and we're going into a power mesh, the power mesh is expecting to warp an image that fits in to the session size. Specifically, it's going to warp using how we've set this stuff up in Mocha. When we're doing things like transforming and adding in transitions, our frame size here is actually bigger than the session size. So we want to clamp this down back to the session size. And there's a number of different ways of doing this. I'm just going to add in a crop node right here. But here's a quick note. The crop will get this effect working, but it won't change the actual domain of definition or the size of the frame. This is going to be preserved downstream, and this will have consequences that we'll have to deal with later. But that's a problem for future Ben. And just to check that the crop is doing what it's meant to be doing, let's press A again to turn the alpha overlay on. And you can see as soon as I start to move my top or my right or my left, it's cropping directly from the session size frame. Lovely. All right. Hit A a couple of times again there just to turn that off. So now when we warp this up, let's bring this into our power mesh. It's warping through with the alpha channel. Very nice. Let's see what happens when we go into the math composite node now. Interesting. All right, well, let's bring this back and let's see what's going on here. We know something's coming through because I can come in and I can change the wipe amount of my clouds here. Let's bring that around about there. And that's taking it into the math composite node, which is set to hard light, right? And one of the consequences of the hard light blend mode is whenever it sees something black, it's going to take it black there. And that's exactly what we've got when we're animating in the transition on the warp clouds. Ignoring the alpha channel, we're taking this in through black. And that's the thing, isn't it? I say ignoring the alpha channel. But we're not ignoring the alpha channel in the math composite, are we? What are we doing with the alpha channel here? Well, we're taking in the alpha channel through a bay mat. And the alpha channel is our arm here. So what we have to do to properly composite our wall with the wipe clouds is to also make a new alpha channel that's being used as the bay mat. And I say a new alpha channel, we actually just have to combine the alpha channels from our arm roto and our power mesh warp. And we have a node that can do exactly that. So if I come into my composite here, I've got my first node, alpha composite. If you're coming from a layer-based workflow, the idea of doing something with an alpha composite might seem a little strange. Layer-based compositors generally use layer order to determine how things merge together. Nodal compositing doesn't do it that way. One of the main powers of the node-based compositing system is that we can build our color and alpha channels in two separate data flows, independently and non-destructively from each other. And it's what stage we merge those streams together that controls the end result. So let's bring that in through the roto. I'll just pipe that in there for neatness's sake. You can see it's still getting the same alpha channel if I ever go through the alpha overlay. And let's bring this out with our secondary alpha channel. And the question becomes, where do we want to take the alpha channel from? Do we want to take it from the transition? Well, maybe not. Do we want to take it from the crop? Maybe. But something else is happening afterwards, which is this warp. And you can see it's warping in the alpha as well as the RGB, as well as the color. So we actually want to take it from our power mesh. And let's do that. So I've got my power mesh dot. I'm going to hold down the Alt key, take a new output, and bring that into my alpha composite. Let's neaten this up, add in a new dot just by alt-clicking on my connection point here. And we now have our new alpha overlay. Hit A one more time so we can see this a bit easier. And let's have a look at the alpha composite node. I've got my two inputs. We're looking both at the alpha channels in them, and then we have the blend mode. So are we going to go with subtract? Well, this almost works. It's getting the upper part of the arm rather than the hand that we want. But let's have a look at multiply. And multiplying those together gives us the result we want and we need. So now if I come back in just to the controls on the wipe cloud, do the wipe amount on that. You see it's wiping incorrectly, isolating the arm, but also just affecting the bit that I'm transitioning in. Excellent. All right, A, one more time just to bring us back. Go back, double click into my math composite and let's animate this up. And we're animating in the wipe clouds. In the parameter window, I can begin animating any property just by clicking on the stopwatch. Once this is active, anytime I make another change to this parameter, either in the parameter window itself or in the viewer, it will add a new keyframe automatically. Come over here, add in a bit of a wipe to start to get the hand happening. And then slowly, 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 as we come in, probably around about here, we can just animate this all the way back up, probably around about here. Let's play that back, see what we get. It's coming in a little bit fast. It's coming in a little bit too sort of uniform. But we can change that up by changing the keyframe distance, and we can tweak the wipe clouds a little bit more as well. But the basic idea that we're going for here is now solid. We brought in our transition, our animation there, and we've used the alpha composite as well to make sure that it's being applied to the right part of the hand and the arm. I think that's a good point to take another quick break. When we come back, we're going to start to look at color correction on the arm and another couple of small things that we can do to help make that sit a little bit better. And in between now and then, I'm also going to just tweak up the animation just ever so slightly. So I'll see you on the other side.